New data from the Bureau of Statistics has revealed the nation is now home to 27 million people. Our population grew by 615,300 over the past 12 months, and overseas migration accounted for 83% of that. Labor has ramped up immigration numbers, and experts are now saying what the rest of us realised a long time ago: governments haven't planned for the growth. Joining me to discuss this and much more is our Friday regular, former Queensland Premier, Campbell Newman. Campbell, thanks for joining me tonight. No wonder there's a housing and cost of living crisis, 615,000 extra people. I mean, it's almost the population of the Gold Coast added to the nation in just 12 months.
James, it's a staggering number. Another one I could give you is that since late 2021, so in 3 years, we've taken in 2 million people. That's another state of South Australia. Last 12 months here in Queensland, we've taken over, I think, about 130,000, the city of Mackay. I mean, look, they are unprecedented levels of new arrivals, and it is, without doubt, putting pressure on the cost of living and on particularly rents and the cost of buying a house. And that's not then to cover, you know, the facts that the pressure on schools, on the road system, on public transport, and, of course, on hospitals. You know, one of the big things we could be doing, by the way, on housing is in one word, it's deregulation. There is so much red tape on actually building new homes. That's absolutely a killer. The private sector was unshackled. Perhaps we'd do a lot better job of at least dealing with that part of the problem.
Yeah, you know, when I invite family to come and stay at my place, I don't get them all there and then think, oh, I've actually got nowhere to put them. You'd think the government would think ahead. Most of us do. Senator Murray Watt says Labor recognises that migration numbers need to be sustainable. Have a listen.
We recognise that we need to make sure that the numbers of migrants that we have coming to Australia is sustainable, and that's exactly why we've taken a range of actions to bring that number down. We're starting to see the results of that, and of course a number of the measures that we've taken took effect after March, so I would expect that we'd see that number fall further.
Campbell, isn't it a bit late to be talking about sustainability when you've already brought them here with no homes?
Look, James, that is absolute bulldust from Murray Watt, who's just another Labor talker. And they will talk and they will talk and they'll talk underwater with a snorkel, mate. You know, he sat in the cabinet as these unprecedented numbers of people have come in. They have been totally asleep. They were elected over 2 years ago and they should have been acting a long time ago. And again, on the housing issue, it's deregulation. We would be far, far better off if we let the private sector get on and deliver the new homes. You know, in the United States, there's been studies done between, say, cities like New York and then Houston in Texas. And the difference is New York's got tight planning controls and housing regulations, codes, etc., whereas Houston many decades ago decided they were going to have very little in the way of that. Houston is affordable. They have low rents. It's a much easier city to get you get a home. And there's the difference. Whereas in Australia, we have for a long time gone down the road of places like New York and Los Angeles. That's why we've got a problem. Our building code, James, keeps getting more and more stuff added on. Fire regulations, smoke detectors, universal access, the size of doors. It just goes on and on and on. Any builder will tell you they're constantly confronted with new requirements that just add cost. There's the charges from local government and there's the delays in getting things approved. This is self-inflicted. Mm. It's self-inflicted because government are shoveling people through the door. It's self-inflicted because we don't allow the private sector to actually deliver those new homes.
Yeah, absolutely. It's infuriating. The nuclear power scaremongering has sparked up again with new Labor modelling, here we go, revealing the Coalition's nuclear plan would add $665 a year to the average power bill. Question: what's more likely to make your life miserable, an explosion in a nuclear power plant or Labor modelling on power prices? Here's what Peter Dutton had to say.
I just think we need to deal with reality here. And this is Chris Bowen, who promised before the election that power prices had come down by $275. They've gone up by $1,000. He's predicting now that in 2037, your electricity bill will go up by $650. I mean, is that credible? Does anyone believe what Chris Bowen has to say? I suspect not.
Campbell, there's been support for nuclear, even in inner city seats. Do you think Chris Bowen is running scared, hence this scare campaign?
Look, it's absolute desperation. And, you know, they continue to say these sorts of things. I think actually Peter Dutton's response was pretty good. How could you trust Labor Party generated modelling? We should have been off, a lot better off by now. But in terms of nuclear and the things that he's saying, it does smack of desperation. Australians are getting the message that the renewables rollout is actually costing them in the hip pocket. I mean, for example, in my own home, we're lucky enough to have been able to afford to put solar panels on. We've got some batteries as well. And guess what? Our power bills keep going up as well because the people in the state government, the Queensland state government owned distribution entity, and the retailers keep jacking up their prices. The more that they see revenue loss, the more they jack up the prices for just being connected to the grid. The final thing is the timeframes for nuclear. I was speaking to a gentleman today who basically, let's call him a former trade envoy for one of the Australian states, who lives in Japan and travels, of course, all the time to Korea. He says the Koreans could deliver nuclear in 5 to 6 years in terms of their construction period here in Australia. They're ready to do it. We have people overseas, you know, close partners of Australia, who are ready to actually help us deliver our nuclear power industry and cheap baseload, reliable power in Australia.
Yeah. Just quickly, before I let you go, I want to ask you about the 2032 Olympic Games, because they're starting to look like they could be an absolute international embarrassment the way things are going. Now, Stephen Miles ruled out redeveloping the Gabba in favour of spending $1.6 billion upgrading QE2 Stadium, which wasn't any good when it hosted the Commonwealth Games 42 years ago. It's 3 kilometres from the nearest train station. It only seats 40,000 people. But if the opposition leader, David Crisafulli, gets into office, he says he'll scrap that proposal and he'll start from scratch with a brand new study to work out what to do. What do you make of this? And is this just going to end up a massive embarrassment for the country?
Well, I hope that Crisafulli is elected, scraps QSAC, and then very quickly comes to a decision about the new stadium, because we will need a new stadium. For my money, it's the proposal by the private sector at Hamilton North Shore. It's a brownfield site, export land, and it's ready there to go. It's close to the Gateway Arterial. You can bring the public transport in, you can bring ferries from the river, you can have cruise ships tied up along the old wharves there and having floating hotels. It's close to the airport. You know, and the private sector want to do this as a PPP, which will minimise the cost to the taxpayers. I think Crisafulli should have a red-hot look at this one as an alternative to some of the other locations that are being talked about.
It's going to be very interesting to see which way he goes, if indeed he does win the election in October. Campbell Newman, thanks so much for your time this evening.